And BBC Two goes on the trail of the python now, with a profile of the team that was first shown on their 21st anniversary, a year after the death of Graham Chapman. Starting with a tribute in the outrageous and distinctly anarchic manner, which was the group's trademark throughout the life of Python.
Graham Chapman, co-author of the Parrot Sketch, is no more. He has ceased to be. Bereft of life, he rests in peace. He's kicked the bucket, hopped the twig, bit the dust, snuffed it, breathed his last, and gone to meet the great head of light entertainment in the sky. And I guess that we're all thinking how sad it is that a man of such talent, of such capability for kindness, of such unusual intelligence, should now so suddenly be spirited away at the age of only 48, before he'd achieved many of the things of which he was capable, and before he'd had enough fun. Well, I feel that I should say nonsense. Good riddance to him, the freeloading bastard, I hope he's fine. And the reason I feel I should say this is he would never forgive me if I didn't, if I threw away this glorious opportunity to shock you all on his behalf. Anything for him but mindless good taste. I could hear him whispering in my ear last night as I was writing this. All right, please, he was saying, you're very proud of being the very first person ever to say shit on British television. If this service is really for me, just for starters, I want you to become the first person ever at a British memorial service to say fuck.
Monty Python was for me one of the great, you know, the great comic delights. I remember saying to myself once that, I'm going to sound a complete farty, but I remember, you know how when you're a, I'm not going to tell you this.
Go on, go on.
Well, you know how when you're a little git at school, in order to avoid doing revision, you write a timetable of your revision. So, like, you don't have to do it because you've actually got a timetable, so tomorrow you'll do it. Do you know what I mean? It's called progressive slowing of rituals, or stuff to do, right? Well, I made a decision that I would do a timetable of revision, and I'd do history that day and geography the next day, etc., which avoided. And I remember writing at the bottom of it, if I got through this timetable, I would buy myself another Python album. I think I had two of them. So it was definitely a delight of my adolescence. There is no question about that.
Nobody expects the Spanish Inquisition. Our chief weapon is surprise. Surprise and fear. Fear and surprise are two weapons, our fear and surprise.
Every once in a while, a television comedy comes along which has an enduring influence disproportionate to the size of its original audience.
My brain hurts!
Such programs get under the skin and grow in the mind, and they make the viewer unable to look at the world in quite the same way ever again.
Not a wink, nudge, 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 nudge. Say no more.
Of all such shows, Monty Python is perhaps the classic example.
Michael Baldwin, this is Bruce. Michael Baldwin, this is Bruce. Michael Baldwin, this is Bruce.
Is your name not Bruce, then?
No, it's Michael.
That's going to cause a little confusion.
Yeah. In a sense, I like to think that I and all my generation made Python, because we were the ones who discovered it, we were the ones who quoted it, we were the ones who kind of bought the books and really wanted them. And the rest of the establishment, the broadcasting establishment, were caught completely unawares. BBC suddenly realised that it had been producing this programme for 4 years, which was of major importance in the history of British comedy.
Until Graham's death, the 20th anniversary of Monty Python didn't really mean very much to me. It seemed too conventional, too neat, not nearly arbitrary enough for Monty Python. But Graham's death changed all that. Suddenly I found myself wanting to look back and celebrate all the things that we did together. For Graham was, in many ways, all the things that we were most proud of in Monty Python. Awkward, outrageous, unconventional, unpredictable, impatient, and often very angry indeed.
When Graham Chapman, with his customary silliness, went and died just one day before the 20th anniversary, Monty Python finally and irrevocably became an ex-flying circus. And with it, an era ended, an era that began for me 20 years ago here in Cambridge. With all the other young gentlemen, I used to cram into the junior combination room over there in the corner where there was a television. And as I was usually late and the room was invariably packed to lurching point, I became a lifelong devotee of the top half of Monty Python. So what did you think you were going to be when you were a kid?
At school we had a careers master who I went to for some sort of help, and he used to direct everybody to go into Pilkington's Glass. And, you know, he talked to you for a long time. He said, well, I'm very interested in Buddhism. I'm terribly good with flowers. I'm terribly good with green fingers and all that. Pilkington's Glass, I think, for you. And someone else would go and say, I'm a physicist. I've got this wonderful sort of new invention. Pilkington's Glass for you. So I was extremely confused by the time I was a teenager. But I never, ever considered the possibility of a career in comedy. That was something. Comedy was sort of Hancock's Half Hour, The Goons, Beyond the Fringe, all these wonderful people who were out there. It didn't impinge on Sheffield. You know, comedians didn't come from Sheffield, I didn't think. You know, they came to Sheffield and then got out again pretty quickly, but they didn't come from Sheffield.
What did you want to be when you were at school?
What age are you talking?
Let's say 7 or 8.
Seven or eight, I just wanted to leave Wolverhampton. Took me another 12 years to successfully achieve this ambition.
But you've done very well then.
Yes, I've managed never to go back.
I remember as a child leaving Wales when I was about 4 and a half and hating the change and disliking where I was translocated to, which was Claygate, Esher, which is a very nice place. I don't want to upset anybody out there, but as a child coming from North Colwyn Bay, I just didn't like it at all. And then for the next 10, 15 years, I was going around saying, I'm Welsh, you know.
I don't think I had any idea, except I wanted to play cricket for Somerset, that I was sure about. I don't think there was any other ambition at all, except perhaps to get out of Western Supermare. We all share that. We all grew up in these rather strange towns we couldn't wait to escape from.
When John Cleese came up to Cambridge, Graham Chapman was already here. Eric Idle was to follow a year or two later, and meanwhile, Palin and Jones were at Oxford. From some of Britain's dullest provincial towns converged this extraordinary group of men, all of them thirsting to become country solicitors or GPs, and yet only 15 or so years later, they found themselves playing to crowds of 50,000 at the Hollywood Bowl. The thing is that Oxbridge gives you a real sense of possibility. Whatever you want to do, here you can learn to do it really well. You come up here perfectly ordinary, but you like to argue. Bob's your uncle, your Ludwig Wittgenstein. Bit of a lefty, before you know it, you're a full colonel in the KGB along with Burgess, Philby and MacLean. But in 1959, the real opportunities here lay in comedy. Jonathan Miller had just left, Peter Cook was writing reviews for the West End, Trevor Nunn was directing for Footlights, and David Frost was nearly famous.
I don't quite know why Oxford and Cambridge, and at this particular time, particularly Cambridge, had such a good track record for humour. I mean, Cambridge has, to its credit, a pack of humorists or satirists or surrealists or whatever you call them, and a pack of conservative cabinet ministers. So now why you have, you know, that particular mixture, I don't know at that time, but it was an extraordinary time to be there. And I think there is a sense in which talent triggers off, ignites talent, and that probably helped everybody.
When David Frost landed his own show, it was not surprising that he looked back to Oxbridge to provide him with writers.
I wrote with Tim Brooke Taylor some... We'd write what he called his CDM, his continuous developing monologue, which John and Graham used to call Odgeril, old jokes and ridiculously irrelevant links. And I learned then the sort of power of being a writer, because I used to live in Notting Hill Gate, and my jokes were sent to the BBC by taxi, and I had to go by tube. The taxi would arrive, and they'd be hot off in the press.
Although it paid peanuts and we got very little material on in the first series, it was our chance to meet, straight out of university, all the sort of really cream of the country's comedy writers, and also some of their best new performers, viz. John Cleese, Ronnie Barker and Ronnie Corbett.
I look down on him because I am upper class. I look up to him because he is upper class. But I look down on him because he is lower class. I am middle class. I know my place.
And John, even then, was sort of, you know, he walked tall. He was tall, I mean. And he's never been somebody who's sort of huddled up to sort of pretend he isn't extraordinarily tall and dominant. So John was sort of striding along, sort of look. And he was very nice and very charming. I remember he pushed Terry Jones over a wall. We were just walking back from Bertarelli's in Shepherd's Bush, having had a little lunch. We were walking back to the place where the Frost was to be recorded, which is the Shepherd's Bush Theatre, where Wogan's now recorded. And sort of, I was just slightly behind. There was a line of people, Jimmy Gilbert, John, Terry, and just walking along. John suddenly stuck a hand out. Terry disappeared over someone's garden wall. I thought, this man is exceptional. Terry did a very good fall, I have to say. A very good fall indeed.
From the contemporary satire of the Frost Report, Palin, Jones and Idle moved on to Do Not Adjust Your Set, where they not only wrote, but began to perform regularly.
And Q. Hello.
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 Dennis and myself are in programme planning. We've been fired again. But anyway, Dennis and myself thought it would be a smashing idea if we were in charge of the whole of television planning. And so we will be.
Applying?
Oh, yes. And so we will be applying for a job. Anyway, Dennis and myself say that this is the last edition of Do Not Adjust Your Set, and we thought that it would be a smashing idea if this went on forever.
No. If we went on forever.
Oh, if we went on forever.
Yes.
Elephants in War.
Do Not Adjust Your Set also gave the first television exposure to a young American animator, Terry Gilliam.
Here, too, was devised that classic military manoeuvre, the Elephant of Surprise.
The things I was doing in the States, in whatever form they were, it was like nobody understood what I was about. They thought I was this freak, this oddity. And was it funny or not? Came over here and suddenly there was an audience that understood it. And I seemed to be on this wavelength that felt right.
What else do we know about elephants? An elephant is able to reverse directions very quickly. Note.
At last, the 1948 show.
Meanwhile, Cleese and Chapman had been brought together with Marty Feldman and Tim Brooke Taylor in a new show, this time produced by David Frost.
Canada English. Today, as usual, we speak only the English. Today, the tea party.
I am a chartered accountant. I am also a chartered accountant. I am a chartered accountant, too.
I am a gorilla.
Cleese and Chapman's writer-performer partnership in the 1948 show produced clear signs of an embryonic Python style.
And we are having tea. This is the sugar.
Sugar.
Meanwhile, Palin and Jones had gone on to write and perform in a little-known series presenting the past as if actually filmed by a modern television crew.
Here, away from the heat of this afternoon's battle, I'm going to try and have a few words with a man who's already being called William the Conqueror, first king of England and Normandy. King William!
And this, too, is recognisably Python-esque.
Congratulations on a wonderful victory.
Thank you very much, David.
You must be very pleased with the boys.
I certainly am, David. They did a wonderful job.
Did you expect to win?
Well, I've never had any doubts, David. The boys have been fighting very well on the continent, but this was the big one that we're all looking forward to.
I remember John ringing me in what must have been about April of 1969, and he said, oh, I've seen the Complete and Utter History. He said, you won't be doing any more of those, will you? So why don't we do something together? And meaning, you know, your lot and our lot.
And so it was that six not particularly angry young men came together to form one of the most famous British comedy institutions ever.
Because we were arrogant in those days, we'd always tell people this is the way it has to be. That was the one thing we were always very good at, is not listening to advice. And I think it's tremendously important in show business. Because people don't know, and they do bluff, and they say, listen, if you want to be successful, this is what you do. You put on nice little suits, you do blackout sketches, and a nice singer. You know, and it's always wrong. It's always out of date and stupid. So because we were a group, we were able to reinforce the strength of not listening to other people.
I, and perhaps the Oxford School, felt very concerned to get a shape that hadn't been used before. And to achieve that, we amalgamated the way Spike was breaking up the forms. I mean, Spike had proved that we were writing in clichés because we hadn't even thought about it, but there we were writing 3-minute sketches or 30-second blackouts.
Whoopee!
And without thinking of it, we were conforming to a set of rules that we didn't need to conform to.
That was John Wells in a censored excerpt from the Mountbatten story. To find out whether people actually did stand for the national anthem, we tried this simple experiment. Example one, Kew Garden.
Spike showed us that we could break that up, and then Terry Gilliam had done this animation called Elephants, which he'd done for Do Not Adjust Your Set, in which he did this sort of scream of consciousness. And it was definitely a conscious idea that we could amalgamate those two elements and create a whole show that was a stream of consciousness.
We stuck to our own usual writing groupings, if you like. I mean, Terry Jones, myself, Eric Idle writing on his own, Terry Gilliam doing his animations on his own, and John and Graham writing together. So we didn't say, listen, this has to be done line by line with the six of us sitting around a table. Let's go away, let's have 2 weeks, write separately, bring in the sketches, read them out to each other, and see how we go from there.
In the meeting, you could say what you want, no, no, and argue and tussle about comedy, but it was never, like, bitter, or it didn't seem to me it ever continued much beyond, you know, let's go down the pub and have a beer. I mean, the people didn't carry any resentments, and still in Python you can say exactly what you want about the material. You know, that's one of the nice things, the freedom to say exactly what you want without saying, oh, I'm sorry to, how can I put this? I don't like, oh, maybe I'm wrong, you know, because that stinks, that's not funny at all. You know, you could have that liberty to say that.
The rule on Python, which was kind of evolved, was that if one person hated it, we probably wouldn't do it, but we might. And if two people hated it, we wouldn't do it. So it could kind of override one veto if everybody was really in favour of it.
I'd say John was the most chairmanly, the nearest we got to a chairman. Because he was, and is, very clear thinking, and also usually in rather a hurry. A combination which was perfect, really, because he would want to get out by a certain time. But he was also, you know, very, very clear about what we had to achieve. And on certain days, that worked very well. On other days, when that wasn't the important thing, it wasn't achieving one thing we were going for, it was actually just trying to sort of open out to get in as many suggestions as possible, then you needed a different sort of technique. So it was by no means a question of one person always being in the chair. I mean, I suppose you could say John and Terry Jones represented the two ends of the spectrum, in a sense. You know, John, if you like, was the head, and Terry the heart of Python.
Yeah, I think John is more. I mean, I think he's very much the Anglo-Saxon in his reaction to things and his outlook on life. And I'm much more the Celt in that I just have this kind of it's more of an emotional reaction to everything first. It's the wheel almost. It's just, whoa. When I played rugger as a child, as a schoolboy, I mean, it would always amaze me at the end of a game when people in the showers would be talking about things that had happened in the match. I mean, to me, I couldn't remember a thing. It was just kind of head down, doing this, doing that. And I think John is always much more removed. He's much more clear-headed. And I think there is a big difference like that, yeah.
Did you argue a lot?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. I'd say it's like a rugby match. I really can't remember an awful lot of it, but I think I only threw a chair at John once.
Well, I used to have a lot of fights with Terry Jones, but they were basically artistic fights because we're very different character types, you know? I mean, Terry is Welsh and is kind of passionate, and I'm sort of repressed and logical. And the two of us used to lock antlers a great deal, but it actually worked extremely well.
I mean, a lot of comedy seems to be like poetry. It's getting its kick out of conflict, out of contrast, of ideas. In poetry, it's what Browning said, when you get two metaphors, it's when you bring two ideas together and they produce not a third idea, but a star. And that's kind of magic. And the same thing with comedy, you bring two conflicting ideas together and you produce a laugh.
Probably about 70% of the audience at those early shows did not know what was going on and were slightly embarrassed to be there at all. And I can remember various people. I mean, Humphrey Barclay, you know, who's a producer of Dad, who was one, didn't get the first show at all. He said, I remember him saying, I just didn't, I thought you'd made a terrible, terrible mistake. And then about the second or third, he suddenly realised that you had to start thinking in a different way and that it wasn't all a mistake. It was, well, some of it might have been, but it was deliberately, deliberately subversive.
And now for something completely different.
When it first started, what was the reaction of the BBC to seeing it on air?
Well, the first reaction of Tom Sloan, who was the head of Light Entertainment at the time, he came into my office as I was being a minor executive. I had an office 2 feet by 4, and I had to share it with 3 other people. And he came in and he said, excuse me, I've just seen the playback of Monty Python's Flying Circus. Does John Cleese have to say the word bastard twice? And I said, yes. I expect so, because if I trust John, if he feels the need to say it twice, I think it's going. I was just asking, and he went, and that was the only criticism I ever heard from the BBC about anything that the Pythons did.
There's a kind of myth around that the BBC is a bit of a stuffy old institution where it's very difficult to get new ideas accepted. Far from it. TW3, Monty Python, Not the 9 o'clock News, The Young Ones, The Ben Elton Show, the BBC commissioned them all with its customary urbane alacrity. There is in this country a very long and honourable tradition of radical and indeed rude comic descent from Rowlandson and Hogarth through to Private Eye and Spitting Image. And from public school onwards, the British establishment deals with rage and subversion not by crushing it, but by promoting it. A student lawyer or medic born in Havana or San Salvador leaves university and plunges straight into the nearest jungle, intent on overthrowing the government. Angry young men, however, born in Dorking or Cheltenham, simply pitch up here at the BBC, get given their own alternative comedy series in a large house, rant at authority for a few half hours, and the dictatorship carries on much as before.
I can remember waiting when the real BBC Globe came up. I do recall this very strongly, waiting, hoping there'd be a bit more. I might sit through 2 or 3 hours of very dull television, hoping that there'd be a bit more Python. Maybe it's not over yet. I mean, I didn't watch it that often when I was a kid, because it was very late and I was only 11, but I do remember that, thinking, it's over, because it was so exciting to watch.
It was Cleese who usually provided the elegant comic structure, but it was often Chapman's surreal alterations, in this case turning a faulty toaster into a dead parrot, which gave their work its distinctive originality.
Graham was a very, very clever writer, and the best judge of whether something's funny that I've ever come across. If ever I was not sure, I would always take Graham's opinion. He seemed to be a sort of perfect litmus paper. The wonderful thing about writing with someone is at the end of it, you have produced something, the two of you, and you know you couldn't have done it individually, and you know that you could never have got there without the other person's input, and you can never, ever remember what the route was that you did get there by. It was this extraordinary kind of magic that happens between people when they're firing on all cylinders, and suddenly you get to this wonderful bit of material, and you just know that it was produced by a creature that the two of you formed.
Funny, that penguin being there, isn't it? What's he doing there? Standing! I can see that!
All the Pythons came from fairly comfortable middle-class existences. So the rebellion, such as it was, amongst the Pythons was not sort of a curse against society, we're going to get you all, you know, which would have sent us sort of, I think, madly off-key and probably into becoming sort of kitchen sink dramatists with a very short life. And sort of our, if you like, our sort of reaction was against a sort of rather stifling world. It was not necessarily oppressive, it didn't hurt us, it wasn't unpleasant, it wasn't unkind, it just was very, very conventional.
Basically what we're doing is we're all laughing at the authoritarian figures that we grew up under and observing. And if I think if you're at a boarding school for about 12 years, your vision of authority is very much that of this looming nonsense, and you're not allowed to laugh at it except privately amongst the rest of your gang. But you know it's nonsense, this assumed authority that's been given to you by teachers, by military figures, because we always had to do the CCF, by police, by judges, and it's all pretending that we know what's going on this planet and this is the way it is, and it's all bullshit. And I think that Python was quite good for getting rid of those inhibitions, and it's why it's still, I think, appealing to the young.
Yes, I agree.
It mocks all the authority figures, including mothers, particularly mothers.
Afternoon, Mother. Afternoon,
Mrs. Knickerbocker. Oh, she's walking already!
Yes, he's such a clever little boy.
Oh!
Hoochie hoochie hoo!
Hello, hoochie hoo! Hello, hoochie hoochie! Oh, look at him laughing, eh? He's a chirpy little fellow, isn't he? Isn't he a chirpy little fellow, eh? Does he talk? Does he talk, eh?
Of course I can talk. I'm Minister for Overseas Development.
Oh, he's a clever little boy! He's a clever little boy!
I think that probably catches the whole point of it. I mean, there they were, mum and friend. And no matter how old you are, no matter what you've done, no matter how long you've been to Cambridge and run multinational companies, there's mum, Nicky, Nicky, Nicky. Ah!
Oh, Mrs. Niggerbait has exploded.
Good thing, too.
You are best friend.
Oh, Mother, don't be so sentimental. Things explode every day.
What do you think about Monty Python's view of women in those far-off days?
Well, actually, yes, they're very stereotyped, I think. You know, Carol comes in as the busty blonde, and I certainly think you can say there's not an awful lot of depth to the to Python's female characterizations.
The fellas were always apologizing to me for not having more for me to do. Michael was always coming up and saying, "I'm sorry, darling, we don't have a lot for you in this one." But as he said, we are just not very good at writing parts for women. And I suppose in that way they were a bit chauvinistic as far as their view of young women. Now, they did write very well for the older women, which, as you say, they played themselves so well, far better than I could. But when it came to young women, they couldn't write funny parts for young women.
I certainly feel not only socially and politically behoven to, but also, I think, comedically anxious to write better parts for women than they ever tried to, because I think you'll have a better show for it. But that's not, I'm not going to throw that back as a criticism. They did their thing and they did it then. But now, people are perhaps more sensitive to what creates an environment of racism or sexism, and they try not to contribute to it. So, you know, even though a gag might be funny, you might not crack it. I mean, I've kept gags out of scripts because I thought, well, in an innocent world, I'd use it, but it's not an innocent world, and I'm not going to be a part of that.
Good morning.
Morning.
Are you the registrar?
I have that function.
Well, I was here on Saturday getting married to a blonde girl, and I'd like to change, please. I'd like to have this one instead.
What do you mean?
Well, the other one wasn't any good, so I'd like to swap it for this one, please. I have paid. I paid on Saturday. Here's the ticket.
No, that was when you were married.
Yes, that was when I was married to the wrong one. I didn't like the colour.
So, the problem on Python about the women was I don't think we knew very much about women.
And you can only write what you know about. So we used to write about sort of showgirls. We didn't really know any, but you could imagine the stereotype. And we used to write about these ridiculous pepper pots who used to make us laugh a lot. I don't quite know who they were. Sort of cross between parrots and our mothers, I think.
The tortured logic of Gilliam's imaginative animations gave the show both a kind of spurious plot and a strong visual trademark.
I think the main point is to not really be too inventive, because I think if you force it, it doesn't really work. Mm. So you take what you find, you use it, you try to make juxtapositions. Say, in the case of this, you know, if you happen to be here and you find these, yeah, you'd probably want to use these in the animation, wouldn't you? I mean, who's that? Albrecht Dürer. This one, I mean, the great thing about these guys is they're dead. I think that's the main reason I've always used these people in my work. Dead painters. You don't have to pay them. You can take their ideas, you can take their artwork. And it costs you nothing. I mean, I used to go always to the National Gallery. Every time I'd run out of ideas, I would run down to the National Gallery for 10, 15 minutes, just walk through, try. And the paintings would start talking to me, and I'd say, oh, I have that one, that one. And one day I was walking through, and it came on this one. And the original painting is gigantic. It's like 10 feet tall. Yeah. I was looking at it, and I thought, isn't that wonderful? And out of the whole painting, the only thing that really stuck with me was that little bit down here, and there it is. It's the big foot.
That's the foot.
That's the one. And I mean, Bronzino would go crazy. I mean, the guy's been years painting this thing, and some jerk comes along in the 20th century and throws away everything except a little bit on the bottom. And just, And there's something very satisfying about doing this. You know, you're dealing with really great art that people pay hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars for, and I'm reducing it to that and then squashing something. Says something about life, I think.
Like all the Python team, Gilliam often delighted in shocking the audience.
As individuals, we're all very nice guys, really. I mean, and people are fairly concerned about things and are understanding of other people. We're not the monsters that we're able to create on the screen. And I think, were we not able to do it, we probably would become those. I mean, it's the Hitler problem, the frustrated painter. You then have to take over the known world, and thank God we've got these outlets.
I certainly think one of the things that Python introduced or accentuated in comedy was aggression, was the comedy of aggression. I think that's very much John's input there.
Shut up! Right now! You, Mr. Apricot!
Harrison!
Ah, Mr. Harrison! Come on me with that banana, then! Come on! Attack me with it! As hard as you like! Come on! Come on!
I think the kind of deaths that we're having are what I call cartoon deaths. Yeah. And I think that the nearer deaths get to cartoon, the more people see it in the same way that they see with Tom and Jerry. You know, when Jerry runs over Tom with the steamroller, there's always two people in the audience who think, oh, God, poor cat, that must have hurt. I hope the cat's all right, you know. But they're in a minority.
Come on! Come on, you worm! You miserable little man! Come at me, then! Come on, do your worst, you worm!
Well, I remember the first time that John read out the sketch about the Undertaker and about arriving with his mother in a sack and the Undertaker proposing to eat her and that. And he read this out and we all laughed. And then I thought, we can't do that. I mean, you just can't do that. I think my mother was very ill at the time, I think. She might have just died, actually, I think. And then I remember going into the kitchen and buying some, making some coffee. And as I was making the coffee, I thought, well, why can't we do it? I mean, it's not encouraging people to eat their mothers.
There's difficulty in comedy. Just as people used to say, well, Johnny Spate ought to be aware that some people took Alf Garnett's views seriously. You kind of hold your head. You say, well, if you have that kind of thinking, you can just get rid of all comedy.
you know. Absolutely straight away you can kill all comedy. Because no joke can actually survive that kind of analysis, because in the last resort, every joke is in some way critical.
Is about seeing deeply, I mean, seeing actually under the surface, into sometimes in the darker areas, but being able to just make a joke of it. But it's the only way you can cope with something that's very unpleasant, very hard, and all the suffering and the nastiness that's in the world. Sometimes the only way you can cope is to make a joke out of it. But that doesn't mean that you haven't experienced that nastiness and that suffering. Very often it means you have, and that's why you know whether, you know, why the humour is so strong.
By 1972, the tensions and dynamics within the group that had once been so fruitful began to turn sour.
In the first two series, now I feel it was like sort of the argument and the discussion and the disagreement was constructive. You know, we were holding it in, we were containing it, and it was actually a driving force that kept us moving along. By the third series, yes, it was getting a little bit destructive. People were actually saying, I don't want to do any more shows.
I think that there was a certain amount of antagonism in the third series, about 1973. And I know that I was unpopular, although they were nice to me, basically, face to face. I mean, they sort of got pissed off and said rude things about me behind my back a bit when I said I wanted to drop out of the group for television purposes.
One got the feeling we were going over old ground, and then we were pushing more. We were relying on, you know, shock words and shock effects to keep it going, because the surprise element was gone. Once you've set up a situation where anything might happen, it's very hard to surprise people.
I think, you know, the decision of the five of us to go on and do the fourth series without John was kind of interesting. And surprising in a way, because we'd always said, well, Python was the six of us, and it was, you know, you take away any one element and it wouldn't be the same.
Then they wanted us to do more. We just did six, and then the BBC wanted another seven, and I'm afraid at that stage I said no, and Michael tried to talk me into it, and I said, well, it's just not working, because John was very... There was this lovely tension between John and Terry. There were a series of tensions and balances that allowed it to work, and without the full group, it never worked quite as well.
And so the Pythons went their separate ways, and although numerous successful collaborations followed, they were never to work together as a group on television again.
But I think that most of that rancor was really isolated in sort of late 73, really, which is a pretty short period of time. I mean, my recollection of the Holy Grail was that even a few months after that, because the Holy Grail was 74, we were all getting on very well. And I remember Life of Brian as being an enormously happy experience, because by coincidence, we all had the same kind of views and feelings about the subject. And I think that's our masterpiece. You know, that's what I would like to be judged by in the future.
Master, your people have walked many miles to be with you. They are weary and have not eaten.
It's not my fault they haven't eaten.
There is no food in this high mountain.
Well, what about the juniper bushes over there?
He has made the bush fruitful by his word.
They've brought forth juniper berries.
Of course they've brought forth juniper berries. They're juniper bushes. What do you expect?
Show us another miracle.
Do not tempt him, shallow ones. Is not the miracle of the juniper bushes enough?
I say, those are my juniper bushes.
They are a gift from God.
They're all I've bloody got to eat. I say, get off those bushes. Go on, clear off. The lot of you.
Lord, I am affected by a bald patch.
I'm healed. The master has healed me.
I didn't touch him.
I was blind and now I can see.
Well, that was an excerpt from the controversial and some would say scurrilous new British picture, the General Synod's Life of Christ.
With the release of Life of Brian came both international controversy and a realisation for the rest of us working in comedy that the Pythons had become irritatingly good. Their timeless surrealism couldn't be bettered, and so topical satire once again swung back into fashion.
Python worshippers claim the film sets out to ridicule by parody the actual members of Monty Python. Men who, even today, are worshipped and revered throughout the Western world. Now, Alexander Walker, what did you think of the picture?
Well, I was appalled. I mean, I actually find it deeply offensive
that in a country that is still ostensibly a python-worshipping country, that a 14-year-old child can actually get in to see this film. I mean, there is little enough proper python around these days without parading this distorted garbage about.
Bishop, you directed the film. Did you expect this kind of reaction?
Well, I certainly didn't expect the Spanish Inquisition.
By now, the pythons had become successful throughout the world, including America, a notoriously difficult market for British comedy.
Big puzzle, because there was only one thing we ever all agreed on, and that was that the show would never work in America. And we were all solid on this. And it was a total surprise that it went, and I think it started in Dallas, on PBS in Dallas, of all places. And in fact, by the time we got to New York to open Holy Grail, it was hugely hip. I mean, it's the thing.
It's a mystery to me. It's a total mystery. I remember somebody once telling me that On the Buses was number one in Yugoslavia with Serbo-Croatian subtitles, and I thought, well, that explains it. You cannot explain it. And I can only suggest that a lot of the stereotypes in Python are also archetypes, that somehow they seem to ring bells in all cultures. People seem to know people who are a bit like this.
I don't think Americans are that interested in Englishmen doing the kind of things they do. But they will be interested in an English person perhaps doing things that English people do best, which is a particular kind of wordplay, a particular kind of sarcasm, a particular kind of nonsense, a particular kind of freedom and breadth, and a particular kind of uninvolvement from the family. All American programs are essentially about families and family values. I mean, even things that were quite good, like MASH, descend into this soupy nonsense of, you know, by the last two series, every episode had an 11-year-old Korean boy that they were patting on the head every 3 minutes and just became revolting.
They particularly influenced a new show on NBC, Saturday Night Live, starring two young unknowns, Dan Aykroyd and Steve Martin.
You know, because they were so good, you always have to think, well, we can't do that because it's like Python. So they influence you in the sense that you have to stay away from something that could be identified with them.
A lot of humor, American humor particularly, in television was based in sort of kind of real social situations and real relationships, and Python takes that basis and just explodes it. And, you know, they're the only people capable in the world, I think, of exploiting a concept like the Ministry of Silly Walks.
Looked at from 20 years distance, what do you think of Monty Python's Flying Circus?
Well, I rather dreaded doing this interview because I seem to have spent more time over the last 15 years talking about Python than I seem to have ever spent actually doing it. And also, when they were running them about 18 months ago, I thought there was an awful lot of dross. I mean, there was usually something, maybe two things, really good, even in a bad episode. But a lot of it wasn't awfully good. Some of it was. The other thing is that what was significant about Python is that awful thing that can never be recaptured. We were doing all the stuff, all those things, for the first time, and that was a delight and a surprise.
Generations of comedians have come and gone who've done stars of television journalist and stars of football commentator and things like that, and it looks perhaps a bit hammier than would now be acceptable, but at the time it was extraordinarily fresh and extraordinarily good. I agree. I mean, if you look back at the recent repeats of the first series, one is actually occasionally slightly surprised by how under-rehearsed it sort of looks, vaguely. But it's in one's memory, it's extremely good, and that's really what matters, just as, you know, one's memory of a particular summer is more important than what actually happened.
You were asking a lot earlier if it was possible to define what it is that makes a show that has a cult quality. And I think it has to live with one. It can't be kind of disposable, no matter how funny a moment is, if it's kind of there just for the moment. You know, I mean, it's got to have depth so that aspects of it return, you know, return to one. And certainly with Python sketches, I mean, just the depth of ideas, like when you start with, let's say, the argument sketch, you start just by simply laughing at I mean, just this funny idea of these two rather pompous men contradicting each other. Just the simple, It's funny. I mean, it is naturally funny. So that's the first one. But then afterwards, the amount of ideas in there, the idea of some room where you can go for an argument, right? Well, that's a terribly funny idea. Beyond that, they employ the semiology of rooms where you really do go for things. Rooms where you go to complain about toasters. Rooms where you go to be interviewed for jobs. They employ exactly the same semiology, and yet for an entirely absurd thing, but they stick to it like glue. They do not let the reality, you know, slip of their insane world. I mean, there's a lot of depth, and you know, I mean, what we're trying to say is, what is it that makes something people really like a lot? And I mean, it's great quality, and that's the Python.
Well, Eric,
yes.
This is the sad question.
Yes.
What is a Python going to do ever again as a group?
I think, first of all, we should be doing a series of tributes and memories and programmes about what it's like to do Python 20 years ago, then 21 years ago, then maybe 22 or 23 years ago, skip a year, then go straight to the 25th anniversary, where we'll talk about how it was creating and doing a comedy show in the early, middle 19th century. And then it's just, I think, attending each other's funerals.
And there's still a lot of competitiveness in the group. It's sibling rivalry, you know, because we are siblings and we're very much contemporaries, very much product of a particular time. And we all want the others to do well, but we don't want them to produce total masterpieces, you know what I mean? Because that would be rather annoying. But at the same time, we don't wish the others bad, you know? We want them reasonable-sized success, yes. You know, but nothing too annoying.
For the good things about it, it was all the old limitations. I've moved away from that. It's doing things I'm not interested in anymore. And from my own personal thing, I like what I'm doing now, and the idea of doing more Python gives me the feeling it's going to be more of that in a strange way, and it's not what I want to do.
When we started, it was a great sort of boost to everybody, and Python became bigger than the sum total. But I think now it would be a sort of like everybody would feel constrained by it. And I think Meaning of Life, I didn't enjoy the writing on that as much as the other films. Just magic just doesn't seem to be there quite the same.
The great thing about Python is we could never believe our luck. We were like a sort of group of people who met at school, still allowed to do these old schoolboy jokes, I mean, not, and behave and do silly voices and get paid for it. I mean, that was the best time, before we got self-conscious, before people started making a sort of critical interpretations of Python's work, calling us about how we thrust aside the barriers of comedy. I mean, we were just a sniggering little group. We had a terribly good time, a bit of a giggle at the human race, and then suddenly we've broken new barriers in comedy, and we all went a bit sort of quiet then.
The influence of Monty Python is still extraordinarily pervasive, even if only because those of us who had the misfortune to try to follow them have had to struggle to think of a different kind of joke. And their sense of humour is much more complex and wide-ranging than the mere word Pythonesque sometimes gives it credit for. In the end, though, it's for taking the comedy of the absurd to its almost ultimate form that they will inevitably be remembered. At Graham Chapman's funeral, there was a magnificent wreath bearing the inscription, "To Graham, from the other five Pythons, with all our love. Stop us if we're getting too silly." And perhaps that's what he's done.
Cheer up. You know what they say. Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, don't grumble, give a whistle, and this'll help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. Life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bow. Forget about your sin, give the audience a grin. Forget it, it's your last chance anyhow. And always look on the bright side of death. A
just before you draw your terminal breath. Well, life's a piece of shit, oh, when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show, keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the bright side of life. Key change. Always look on the bright side of life. I'd just like to be the last person at this meeting to say fuck. Thank you very much. God bless you, Graham. Thank you.